Hello everyone, welcome to the course on medical biomaterials. We will continue on the topic of biopolymers or natural polymers. They seem to have a very good future in design of novel biomaterials with in conjunction with synthetic polymers or even with the metals, ceramics and so on actually. So we saw this slide in the previous class. So we have the natural polymers, we have the synthetic polymers. So synthetic polymers could be polylactic acid, polylactic glycolic acid, polycaprolactone, polymethyl methacrylate, polyethylene glycol and so on. So these are all synthetic, that means you synthesize them in the lab. Then we have the natural, that means they come from the plants or they come from bacteria, fungi, animals and so on. So here we have two types, the polysaccharides, the proteins. Polysaccharides, as the name implies, it contains different types of sugars in a polymeric form. So it could be starch, alginate, chitosan, chitin, glucons, then hyaluronic acid and so on. Now other type is proteins, that means they have the amide bond, C double bond O N, that's the C double bond O amide bond. So it could be collagen, fibrin, silk, all those come under this category. So all these are called natural polymers. They have many advantages. So one would like to make use of them. They are biocompatible. These biological recognition property, that means cells are able to recognize them as a compatible material. So generally the cell adhesion differentiation is excellent when compared to synthetic polymers. But they also have disadvantages, poor mechanical properties. They have immunogenic issues. Like if you are taking material from animals, can we have contamination, toxicity? Then limited supply, we cannot produce it in large supply like say polyethylene or polypropylene or polymethyl methacrylate in an industry. So obviously there is a limited supply. So the polysaccharides we saw, that means they are made up of monosaccharides like this. Okay, then this is called a glycosidic linkage, O glycosidic linkage. Okay, so we call this as 1,4 because this is 1 and this is 4, and this is called 1,6 linkage because we have the 1 here and the 6 here, and these are called the alpha. Alpha means the OH which forms the bond is below these saccharide, whereas if the OH comes above, then we call it the beta linkage. Okay, so there are different types of polysaccharides. We can have alpha linkage, beta linkage, we can have 1,4, 1,6, 1,3. So different types of linkages, different types of sugars, monosaccharides, you end up having a large variety of polymers of this type. Okay, so starch for example has got this alpha 1,4 linkage, and this 1,6 happens once in 30. So when we have 1,6, obviously you are going to have the branching. If it is totally 1,4, then it's going to be very linear and crystalline. When you have branching, it becomes a little bit amorphous, less crystalline. Okay. Hyaluronic acid. This is produced by bacteria. It's found in connective tissues, epithelial, humor of the eyes in mammals, neural tissues. So it's a very important polymer. It's called hyaluronic acid. So we have the D-glucuronic, okay, D-glucuronic, that's the acid glucuronic, and N-acetyl glucosamine. So we have the amine here, we have the acetyl CH3CO group here, okay, and they are linked by beta, unlike the alpha which is down, beta is up. So this is how the hyaluronic acid is found. Then we also looked at chitin. Chitin, as you can see, has this acetyl in the nitrogen amine connected, so it's N-acetyl glucosamine polysaccharide. Okay, it's most abundant next to cellulose. It's very useful. Then we saw chitosan. You produce chitosan from chitin, that means you remove this acetyl group using a deacetylase enzyme, so you end up having an H2. Okay, so this is highly water soluble. Depending upon the degree of removal of deacetylization, we can have the solubility very high or very low and so on actually, whereas chitin is not soluble. Okay, so this is a sort of a morphological picture of chitosan. Okay, it's insoluble at pH greater than 7, but at pH less than 6, positively charged these amino groups increases the solubility. So this is deacetylization. Alginates. So alginates, alginic acid, and so on. Okay, gober gum, for example. So it contains mannuronic acid connected by guluronic acid with a beta linkage. As you can see, this is a beta linkage. So those with high guluronic acid content are used good for biomedical application because they are stiff. When this guluronic acid amount goes down, then it loses its stiffness. Okay, so these are produced by brown seaweeds, several types of brown seaweeds. Okay, so this gives a stiffness, more soluble at lower pH than GM block. Okay, so the G content can vary between 40 to 70%, and the molecular weight is 50 to 100,000 kilodalton. So alginates can be used for drug encapsulation. Cellulose. Okay, this is what cellulose is. Okay, they are all connected. Okay, like this. So they are found in cell wall of the plants. It's most abundant biopolymer. It's most abundant biopolymer. So we have the anhydroglucopyranose here. Okay, anhydroglucopyranose, as you can see here, and they are connected by this beta linkage here. Joined covalently by acetal, functions between the C4 and the C1, right. So they are connected by the C4 and C1, carbon beta 1,4 glycosidic. So the beta 1,4 glycosidic linkage, okay, the beta 1,4, this is 1 and this is 4, bestows resistance to chemical and enzymatic attack. These are linear chains, okay, linear chains with 1000 to 2500 monomer units. So we are talking quite a large molecular weight. Okay, so the degree of linearity and presence of extensive OH group, lot of OH groups are present, leads to inter and intramolecular hydrogen bond. So we can have lot of inter intramolecular. Okay, so it ends up being a crystal in a parallel arrangement. So we can have one chain, another chain, another chain. So it becomes a crystallized. So it influences its physical and chemical properties. So it's widely found. It's crystalline in nature. Okay, lot of OH groups. So it forms very good hydrogen bond. So it's poor solubility in common solvent because it's very crystalline, poor crease resistance, starch. If you remember olden days, when you put starch to your clothes, you have to iron them because it's got very poor crease resistance, poor dimensional stability, it lack of thermoplasticity, high hydrophilicity. As you can see, lot of OH groups, so it's very, very, very water soluble. It does not have antimicrobial properties. Degradation is also very slow, up to 60 weeks. So what is done is there is physical chemical modifications. We can remove some of the OH using acetyl so that we reduce the crystallinity and also we can reduce the water solubility. Okay, that's the thing. So applications, hemodialysis membranes. They make, if you remember, those who have a problem with their kidney and it doesn't function properly, removing the urea and creatinine, obviously they have to have this hemodialysis done for purification of the blood for patients with renal failure. Okay, so cellulose diacetate membranes are used. Okay, and there's a company called Altin which makes, it's less toxicity. Okay, blood filtration devices, we can separate red blood cells, leukocytes. So if you are interested in red blood free plasma, then we need to filter the blood, then cellulose acetate type of membranes are used here. Scaffolds for cardiac regeneration, so cellulose acetate and regenerated cellulose fibrous matrix supports the growth of cardiac myocytes. So we can use them for tissue engineering applications for growing cardiac myocytes. So these are the applications of this particular product. Then comes carboxymethyl cellulose. So we can convert this, if it is H, of course you have the alcohol. So we add the carboxymethyl here, then the solubility of it goes down, crystallinity also goes down. Then it can be used for drug delivery, release of, for example, a drug to regulate motor response in Parkinson's disease. When they are incorporated in CMC powder, then we can increase the sustained release of the drug, okay, in nasal applications. Scaffolds in tissue engineering. The CMC hydrogels, they are pH dependent swelling characteristics. So they can swell and absorb water, so and they, hence they can capture drugs and then it can slowly release at the right pH. Okay. The potential wound dressing material, when it is combined with chitosan or hydroxyapatite, it can also be used in bone and dental applications. As you know, hydroxyapatite used quite a lot in bone, chitosan also has very strong, so it can be used in dental. So carboxymethyl cellulose will have a good biocompatibility, so they can be combined together. Okay. Microbial cellulose, these are the cellulose previous ones we saw or plant derived. Microbes also produce cellulose like Acetobacter xylinum, chemically similar to plant cellulose. So they have a microfibril and nanostructured arrangement. They can retain water. They have very good biocompatibility, great elasticity, high wet strength, conform. So it can be used in wound dressing, production of vascular conduits, bone scaffold. So they are to be combined, of course, with the HA for bone filling and so on actually. Then comes glucons. Glucons are also polysaccharides, either low very low, high molecular weight or low molecular weight polysaccharides. So alpha glucons and beta glucons are there. Polysaccharides of D-glucose monomers linked through these glycosidic bonds. So alpha, of course, you have the O below, like I talked about. So we have the 1,4, 1,6 type of arrangement. You see this 1,4, 1,6, okay, type of arrangement. So if you have here and here, it's 1,6. If you have here and here, it's 1,4. Alpha, the bond, the glycosidic bond is below. Dextran, it's an alpha 1,6 glucon. Glycogen, it's an alpha 1,4, 1,6. Pullulan, alpha 1,4 and 1,6. Starch, alpha 1,4. Okay. So all these are alphas, and they are called glucons. High molecular weight polysaccharides with D-glucose monomers combined. Okay, in a linear fashion. We also have beta glucons. Okay, the alpha glucon we have the O below. In the beta we have the O above. They are found in the cell walls of bacteria, fungi, yeast, algae, lichen, plants such as oats and barley. Okay, so that's the beta. So we can have beta 1,3. Okay. Okay, or we can have beta 1,4. So different types of beta glucons are also possible. Okay, so we can see the beta 1,4. If you have this bond 1,2,3,4, so 1,4, or we can have the beta 1,3. That means 1,2,3. Okay, so different types of combinations are possible. These are long chain polymers of glucose. They have this beta linkage. Okay, so if it is 1,3, it's going to be a very linear 1,3 structure. You can have 1,4 that can lead to branching. Okay, you can have beta 1,6 also. Okay, so these linear glucons, 1,3 linear glucons can form helical structure. They have gelling properties. The gelling property can be affected by modifying the temperature. Okay, so quite a lot of applications are already in use on these beta glucons. Okay, so the characteristics, so it depends on the linkage type, that means 1,3 or 1,4 or 1,6, degree of branching, because when you have 1,6 you can have molecular weight, how many chains. Linear beta glucons can even be 60-70 kilodalton. Conformational, because these linear glucons can form triple helix, single helix or random coil. Okay, so they give them the gelling property which changes with temperature. Lower level of branching and lower polymerization degree, it's better solubility. But large molecular weight beta glucons are not water soluble. They are soluble only in formic acid or alkali. So examples of beta glucon: cellulose, beta 1,4, curdlan, beta 1,3, laminarin beta 1316, chrysolaminarin beta 13, lentinin beta 1613, lysinin beta 1314, pluran beta 13 and beta 16, zymosan beta 13. So we have different types of examples depending upon the glycosidic linkage. Okay, so beta 13 Kirtland, it's widely found. Bacteria also produces this, and it's this is a beta 13 glucan. Okay, beta 13. It's also called Kirtland. As you can see, it's got gelling properties. It forms a triple helix type of structure, which forms and breaks depending upon the temperature. So these are linear glucan composed of beta 13 glycosidic linkage. This is called glycosidic linkage. Okay, molecular weight 10^4 to 10^6. Okay, bacteria produces Agrobacterium, Rhizobium, alkali genes, they all produced maybe about 50, 60, 70 grams per liter. So it's widely find lot of applications. It's insoluble in water, alcohol and organic solvents, but it dissolves in base dilute bases, dimethyl sulfoxide, DMSO, formic acid. Okay, it's used, it's registered in the USA by in 1996 by the food FDA as a food additive. So it's quite used in tech soup thickening. It's for entrapping flavors, fragrance, okay, in noodles. So it's widely used in food. Okay, it possesses anti-tumor property, anti-HIV, anti-inflammatory, anti-infective, wound healing properties. Of course, it's got very poor tensile properties. It's got good compressive, so obviously we cannot use it on its own. It needs to be taken with some other synthetic polymer to look at biomedical application. Applications: encapsulation within gels. It gets prepared by heating the suspension of Kirtland in aqueous solution, then cooling it. Drugs like indomethacin, salbutamol, sulfate, prednisone have been encapsulated. It provides sustained release of drugs. It can be also used for drug delivery through rectal administration, suppositories. We can also make nanoparticles of these, of Kirtland, because it's hydrophobic component in amphiphilic drug delivery vehicle. We can graft polymer, copolymer Kirtland with PEG, and then put in a drug like doxorubicin, which can lead to sustained drug release. Okay, that's another example. Immunotherapy, because these beta glucan, the linear beta glucans, the beta 13 linkage gives them the immunomodulatory properties. So it seems it stimulates cytokine production, oxidative burst, increased phagocyte and lymphocyte proliferation. So it can be looked at cancer resistance, disease immunity, wound healing. It also been reported for tumor inhibition ratio. It also gives good inflammatory response and provides infection resistance, and the survival against staph aureus in mice increased from 70% to 97% with glucan administration. The beta 13 gives immunomodulatory properties, and hence these are possible applications of this beta glucan or Kirtland. Wound healing, they can recruit macrophages to wound site and increase collagen deposition. So we can combine beta glucan collagen matrix as wound dressing, especially for burn wound healing in children. Decreased healing time, improved cosmetic results. Then comes cyclic glucans. The beta glucans, the linear beta glucans I mentioned is about 60 to okay, it's almost 10^5 Dalton molecular weight, and it's not water soluble. It's been approved by FDA. These cyclic glucans, on the other hand, are small molecular weight biopolymers. They have a cyclic structure like this. They have cyclic 1316 or cyclic 12. They are very hydrophilic. They are water soluble, but the inner cavity is hydrophobic, so we can put in hydrophobic drugs very conveniently. The inner cavity diameter is about 1.5 nanometer. This is a picture of 1316 cyclic beta glucan produced by Japonicum. It contains 13 glucose units, and this is a 12 beta cyclic glucan okay, So the degree of polymerization is 17, that means there are 17 glucose units, okay. So these two are common, cyclic 1316, cyclic 12. They have big inner cavity diameter, so we can even encapsulate large drugs into it, okay, that is the advantage also. What are the advantages? They can form inclusion, so may find industrial applications in food, pharmaceutical industries. There are some literature where they have been used for chiral separation of biomolecules, small molecules, using the advantage of the slight the cavity that is present in the cyclic beta glucan. It has got greater water solubility than cyclodextrins. We are talking in terms of 250 grams per liter soluble in water when compared to 18 grams of cyclodextrin, okay, that is the advantages. The large cavity diameter of cyclic beta 1 glucan, okay, may permit the formation of inclusion complex, because the inner cavity diameter, say for example of 1316, is about 1.5 nanometer. It's got lower viscosity. It's not subject to retrogradation, that means degradation, which is observed in conventional starches when it is kept for over a long period of time. So they don't degrade, so they may have better shelf life. Now comes proteins. We looked at the polysaccharides. Polysaccharides are those which have sugar in them, arranged different types of sugars arranged in alpha or beta, connected with the 1,2, 1,3, 1,4, 1,6 type of linkages. So different types of sugars, we have amino groups present, then acetyls, deacetyled and so on. Now comes protein, that means they have an amide bond, okay. They are produced by condensation of amino acids, that is polyamide. So they will have a, all of these will have an amide bond, that means a peptide bond CONH, that because of the reaction between NH2 and COOH, that is how you form this CONH group, okay, they are called amide bond or peptide bond. So there are proteins which are naturally occurring, different types of proteins, we will look at them. They are found in living things, present in skin, organs, muscles, hair and fingernails. So obviously they can find applications in tissue engineering, okay, they can find application in wound dressing and so on actually. For example, collagen, it is widely found in our body, keratin, silk, elastin. So all of them have very good biocompatibility, biorecognition properties, okay. For example, collagen is most abundantly found protein in the body. There are 28 collagen types, type 1, 2 and 3 comprise of 80% of all collagens within the body, because the 1, 2, 3 and 5 constitute the essential part of collagen in bone, cartilage, tendon, skin and muscle, okay. It is composed of triple helix like this, you know, collagen has a triple helix. So they have two identical alpha 1, these are called, and there is something called an alpha 2. There is a slight difference in their chemical composition, they are connected as a triple helix. They get denatured, if you denature you will get them, and if you have the enzymatic degradation of, you will get short peptides, small peptides like this actually, collagen, okay. So the structure of collagen was originally discovered as you know by an Indian scientist, G. Ramachandran, Professor G. Ramachandran. Found out that it forms a triple helix. It is composed of a triple helix, two identical chains alpha 1 and then one middle one that is called alpha 2. So the alpha 1 has a molecular weight of 95 kilodaltons, width of 1.5 nanometers and 0.3 micron, okay. So the composition of collagen is atypical for proteins, okay. So it's got very high hydroxyproline content, okay. So it causes very high hydroxyproline content. So the, what are the properties? It's got low antigenicity, low inflammatory and cytotoxic responses. It's got very high water affinity. It got good cell compatibility and availability of various methods for isolating from variety of sources. biodegradable, it's found, collagen is found in human bones and tissues in abundant. So obviously when we make a material with collagen, the system, the human body and human system will not consider it as a foreign body. So hence there is a lot of research being done on collagen as a possible biomaterial in the tissue engineering area, in cartilage design, in filling, in orthopedic area and so on actually, okay. So advantages: available in abundance and easily purified from living organism, non-antigenic, biodegradable, bioresorbable, non-toxic, biocompatible, synergic with bioactive components. So it's got good tensile strength and minimal expressibility, hemostatic, it promotes blood coagulation. Disadvantages: pure type 1 collagen is very expensive. So variability of isolated collagen, cross-link, there are a lot of variations. Cross-link density can change, fiber size can change, there could be impurities. Because it's highly hydrophilic, it could start swelling, and hence if we have encapsulated any drugs, it will be rapidly released. So variability in enzymatic degradation rate as compared with hydrolytic degradation. Complex handling properties, there are a lot of side effects. For example, if I isolate a collagen from a bovine, so we could have some toxicity, bovine spongiform, encephalopathy and mineralization, all these foot and mouth disease which can get transmitted from these animals. So the scare of that is very, very serious. So it can be used for many things already. It's cat gut sutures, first recorded use of collagen in a biomedical product, surgical sutures, so it degrades by the body, repair of wounds and severe tendons in gladiators. It's got full tensile strength which remains for 7 days. Then vascular prosthesis, so already there is a product, OmniFlow, which is used for vascular prosthesis. So collagen polyester composites used for peripheral arterial reconstruction, a sound structural durability, long term patency rates, low infection rates, okay. Adhesion barrier membrane, it reduces internal scarring following surgery by separating the internal tissues and organs during healing. It's got good handling property, it conforms readily to tissue contours, then shields for bandage, contact lenses which gradually dissolved in the cornea. So the mechanical properties of the shield protect the healing corneal epithelium from the blinking action of the eyelids. It also delivers drug to the ocular surface, lubricates the surface of the eye, increases the contact time between drug and cornea, increases epithelial healing. So a lot of advantages of collagen. So as I said, there are already some products in the market, and there is a lot of research being done on the use of collagen into biomedical applications. We will continue further on these protein-based natural biomaterials in the next class also. Thank you very much for your time.